Okay, so the pressure for me to be replaced by Shimon, which is Whisky, no, which
is Vinchevsky.
Vinchevsky. The family names in Polish are not so easy for us. Who is presenting this introduction to parallel programming? We spoke a bit about parallel programming in the last lesson, and so he is more expert than me.
Okay, so thank you for the introduction. Okay, I came here from Gdańsk, which is in the north of Poland. Every day I work at the Gdańsk University of Technology and the Faculty of Applied Physical Mathematics, and I will give you a short course about parallel programming with the message passing interface. Okay, so we have 6 hours, 2 sessions, 3 hours today and 3 hours tomorrow, 2 meetings. Few words about this course details. We will discuss the basics of the parallel programming, and then we'll move to MPI. So during the lecture you may ask questions. If something is unclear for you, just raise your hand or just ask. You can also ask questions after the lecture. You may also contact me after this course via email. This is my email address. These slides will be available for you. So I will put them after tomorrow's meeting, and they will be available to download from this address. It's slightly complicated.
No, but I'll put it on the
on your site,
on the Moodle site. Of
okay, so they are not available right now, but they will become available after tomorrow's course. Okay, so this short course will consist of 2 parts. The first part will be rather, let's say, general and theoretical. We'll spend 3 hours, and the second part will be more practical. So during today, we'll discuss the theoretical part. So I will present the basics of parallel processing. So we will first try to answer why do we need parallel computers, where do we need parallel processing, and then we'll try to answer the question how we measure the performance of computers and parallel computers, what are the common measures, and then we'll discuss the differences between serial and parallel computers. This is something that is important to understand if you want to write a program that is parallel. Parallel programming is different than serial programming, so we need to know the differences and similarities. And then I will show you some examples of parallel computers. We'll also discuss 4 typical ways to compute, something what is called Flynn's taxonomy. And then we'll discuss memory models that I use. And at the end, we'll try to answer the question how to decompose the computational problem. This is also something that is very important in parallel programming. Okay, so what are the approaches to decompose the computational problem? Okay, so this is the schedule for today, and tomorrow we'll move to message passing interface. So I will give you some short overview about this library, about the standard. In fact, it is a standard. Then we'll discuss the structure of the message. We'll discuss basic point-to-point communication methods. I will tell you a few words about the initialization and deinitialization of this MPI environment. A few words about collective communication, and then we'll spend a lot of time on computer exercises. Okay, so this is something that I think that is very important. We'll try to write some simple, very simple parallel programs using this message passing interface library, such that you will be able to see what is the structure of the program, how to use these functions, how to use this library to write a parallel program. Okay, and then I will also show you how to compile this program and how to run it. Okay, such that after this course, each of you will be able to write, let's say, not so complicated, but parallel programs. Okay, so this is the outline. Okay, so let's move to the first problem. The question, why do scientists need parallel computers? This is something that is important, and I think that this is the place. Well, I don't need to answer that question. You have subject with Professor Bagnoli, and we are discussing what are the applications of the computational physics. And there are also some other areas when powerful computers are used, such as computer ID design. I think that probably some of you met with it, with this kind of methods. You can project, design some structure, optimize it, and so on. Computers also find many applications in computational fluid dynamics and in computational nanotechnology. This is the area where I, in fact, work. And also in quantum chemistry and many more. There are many examples of such problems when we need, which cannot be solved analytically, okay? Because this is what is important to know. You may formulate some problem, you may use some theory, try to predict something, and often you come to the situation when you cannot solve equations analytically exactly, and then use numerical methods to solve the equations. And this is where the computers are needed. Okay, so another problem is how to measure and compare the performance of computers. Okay, so this is what we are interested in. If you have a very difficult problem to solve, if you have a very difficult equation or very difficult system to model, then you need a very powerful computer. Okay, so the question is how we can measure the performance of the computers. How these computers, typical, this calculator, of course, it is also a computer, how do they differ with respect to the computational power? So this is something that is often very important. Okay, so just by some analog, we can try to answer the question how we can measure the performance of other objects, like a car. With car, it's very easy because we can measure the performance just by looking at it. Okay, so it's very simple. We can very easily say that this car, racing car, has the highest performance, and this one has the lowest. If we have a problem, if we cannot measure the performance of car by looking at it, then we can consult a speedometer, take a look at the maximum velocity, and this will also tell us something. Okay, so sometimes some other factors, not only the maximum velocity, are important, like acceleration or fuel consumption. Now we can try to use the analog strategy, and can try to answer the question if we can use the same approach in the case of the computer. Okay, so in the case of the computer, we don't have something like a velocity, but we have something that is some quantity, some measure characteristic that is similar. It is frequency of the clock. Okay, so I think that everyone knows what it is. So we can try to compare the speed, the performance of the computers by looking at the frequency. But it works only in the case of the computers which possess the similar architecture. Okay, if you have two PC class computers, then you can directly, let's say, compare these computers by looking at the frequency. But if you have computers which possess different architecture, like here we have a laptop and here we have a cluster, then we cannot measure the performance of computer by looking at the clock. Okay, so they run at the same clock, but the computational power of these two machines is completely different. Okay, so this is not the best approach if we have different machines, if we have computers with different architecture. Okay, so what can we do? We can introduce another measure, not the clock rate, but we can try to look on how the processor that determines, that mostly influences the performance of the computer, how it works. Okay, so we all know how processors work. They take some data and perform some operation, some instruction, execute some instruction on that data, like a multiply to two numbers or something like that. Okay, so we can try to measure the performance of the computer by measuring the number of the instructions that we can perform within 1 second. Okay, so and there is a measure that is very, very popular. It's called MIPS, and this is abbreviation that stands for million instructions per second. Okay, so we can run some calculations and measure how much time do we need to perform some amount of operations. Okay, so what is important to know is that MIPS is not equal to the frequency. Okay, so just to show you, just to convince you, so the first case, usually computers need several clock ticks to execute an instruction. For example, if you want to perform instructions such as multiplication, you need more clock ticks than one. Okay, so it's more complicated instruction and you need several clock ticks. So this explains why usually this MIPS index is less than frequency. Okay, so this is the first case that we can find. The second case is that some computers are able to execute multiple instructions in the same time. For example, this is something that is called pipelining. You can find this technology, for example, in computers of Pentium 4 class and more. And other newer computers, processors. So, for example, this Pentium 4 computer can, on average, process 5 instructions at the same time in 2 clock ticks. Okay, so this is the measure. So in this case, this MIPS index is greater than the frequency. Okay, so as you can see, these two measures, these two quantities are not equal. What is important to know is that this index, it measures the performance of the CPU, the central processing unit, the processor, something that we call processor central processing unit. And obviously, the higher quantity we get, is the better the processor of the computer is. In this MIPS index has many drawbacks, and the most important, especially if you are working in the science, if you are a scientist, is that this MIPS index measures only the performance of the CPU, central processing unit. Okay, you count just the number of the instructions. It doesn't take the account into account the performance of other components, such as memory or hard drive and so on. This is something that is also very important in scientific computations. For example, the speed of the memory is often very crucial. Okay, if you want to perform some operations on the data, you need to get some information from the memory, then multiply numbers and so on. So the speed of the memory can be crucial. There are also some drawbacks of this index. One is that the producers often specify the peak performance, not the average performance. Okay, so this measure doesn't tell what kind of the instruction we need to perform. Okay, so there are many instructions that you can perform, for example, addition, subtraction or multiplication, or more advanced like division and so on. Okay, so it doesn't tell anything about the type of the instruction. So depending on the set of the instructions that you are executing, you will get different value. Okay, so in scientific computations, we are more often interested in floating point operations. Okay, so this is something that is important, especially in physics and the other areas of science. So this MIPS index, as I told you, measures the performance of the CPU. In the case of the FLOPS index, this is the second measure that can be used. We are focused on the performance of the FPU. Okay, so this is floating point unit. In fact, this part of the processor that is responsible for performing floating point operations. Okay, so this is something that is important in sciences, in engineering, in technology. Okay, so we are often operating on some floating point numbers, single precision, double precision, and so on. Okay, so this is another common measure, the FLOPS index, and it counts as opposite to this MIPS index. It counts floating point instructions only. Okay, so we are focused on that. And it's especially useful in the case of scientific computations, because most of the scientific computations are FPU intensive. Okay? So it means that there are many floating point operations. Okay, so now once we know the measures that we can use to try to characterize the performance of computers, we can try to take a look what is the performance of the computers and how it changes along the years. Okay, so this is a graph which shows how the performance of the personal computers changed along time. So since 1980 to 2005, and here we have the performance given as MIPS index. Okay, so this is million instructions per second. So this is where we are. Okay, so now we are somewhere here, of course, but this gives you some idea. There are also some other computers that are completely different than personal computers. There are also supercomputers, which are used by scientists, and we can also can try to look what is the performance of the supercomputers. And here is the graph that shows how the performance of the supercomputers change along the time. So this second line shows this is the trend line. So this horizontal axis starts at 1960s, and this is the performance of the computers given using this flop unit. Okay, so we have in fact gigaflops. So 1000 is 1 gigaflop. It's 10^9 flop. Then we have teraflop and petaflop. So this is how this performance changed along the time. So these are computers, Cray 1 and Cray 2. I don't know if you heard something about this. Later I will tell you something. But these were vector computers. Now we are somewhere here. Now the power of machines is greater than petaflop, which is 10^15. Okay, so this is a very significant increase in the performance.
The funny thing is that now the mobile phones have the same capacity of Cray 1 that I remember.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, so the computers that were considered in 1960s, 1970s supercomputers are slower than today's personal computers. Okay, so we have two classes of machines: personal computers, which display lower performance, and some supercomputers, which are good for scientists, for scientific computations, for some special problems. And these machines display power that is approximately 10,000 times greater. Okay, so this is the ratio between a typical power of personal computer and supercomputer. Okay, so these are two main conclusions. Aside from personal computers, we have also supercomputers that possess higher processing power being approximately 10,000 times greater. And what is also important, I don't know if you heard about this, but if we take a look at these dependencies, you see that this change of the computational power in time is exponential. Okay, so this is something that is well known, Moore's law, which tells that that in fact it can be formulated in many different ports. One way to formulate Moore's law is that the complexity of processors doubles every 2 years. So you may consider the complexity to be the number of the transistor that the processor is made of. Okay, so and in fact this law works since 1965, since people start to build computers. First, let's say, based on transistors. And another view of Moore's law, this is something that is shown on this graph, is that if F is the number of the computations per second per each $100 paid for the hardware, then Y, F of T, this number of computations grows exponentially. Okay, so this is something that holds. And this law works even backwards in theory. If you take a look what kind of let's say machines people were using before transistors, then you will find that this law also works backwards. Okay, so now we can go back to this graph, and we can try to answer how it is possible such that there are some computers that display computational power that is much more greater. Okay, so how these supercomputers are built, and how we can achieve such a high computational power. So initially, this is what I told you, but initially supercomputers were vector computers. Okay, so vector computer is a machine which is able to operate on many data simultaneously. Okay, so we don't have such a situation like in a typical processor that, for example, we execute some instruction like a multiplication on a single number, but we execute the same instruction on large number of numbers. Okay, so such a vector computer is able to, for example, to take one variable and the next 31 numbers and multiply all of them by 3 all at once. Okay, and one executing just one instruction. Okay, so it will take the same time for the vector computer as for serial computer to multiply one number. Okay, so this is one possible approach to increase the power of the computers. And as I told you initially, supercomputers were vector computers. So this is an example of a vector computer, Cray 1 computer, which was put to use in 76. So this is how it looked. Okay, so I don't know this guy, so don't ask me who is this. And so what was the characteristic of this Cray 1 computer? So it had long vector registers. Each register could store 64 bit numbers. Okay, so and then this, owing to this, this computer was able to add, multiply, subtract, and so on, 64 large numbers at once. Okay, so instead of one number, like in the case of serial computer, we were able to operate on 64 large numbers at once. And also it had separate pipelines for different instructions, like addition and subtraction. So these operations were realized in separate systems. So this computer was able to perform different instructions at the same time also. Okay, so you were able to perform addition using some circuits, some part of the computer, and at the same time you were able to perform multiplication for some different data also in this vector mode. Okay, so this is, in fact, this was the first successful vector computer, fully successful vector computer. This is one of the possible approaches, one of the ways how can we improve the performance of the computer, okay, by using vector processing. Instead of having one FPU, okay, you can take a look at this, like in a serial computer we have CPU and we have single FPU, for example. Central processing unit gives some data to FPU and then we are able to perform operation on this single data. In the case of vector computer, we have one CPU, but we have many FPUs. Okay, so this is one FPU, then we have the second one, and so on. Okay, and we can perform the same instruction on many different data. Okay, so on high number of numbers. Okay, so you can take a look at this in that way. Okay, so the vector computers were first successful supercomputers. So initially supercomputers were vector computers. These two machines that I took here, Cray 1 and then Cray 2, were vector computers. So this is how it looked initially, but then the situation has changed. Okay, so this vector, if you take a look at the history of the supercomputing, you will see that vector computers were popular only in 70s and 80s. Okay, and then, but they are not very common today. It's difficult to find a typical vector computer today even. Okay, there are some, but they are not very common. If you go to some supercomputing center and take a look at the machines that are installed in the supercomputing center, you will see that there are no supercomputing in more than 90% of supercomputing centers. Okay, so the main drawback of the vector computers was that they multiple processing units could only work with a single instruction. Okay, so this is the main limitation. Okay, we were able to execute the same instruction for multiple data, but we were able only to execute the same instruction. Okay, so this is some kind of limitation. In fact, in scientific computing, you have often such a situation that you need to perform many different instructions for many different data. Okay, so this is something that often is very important if you want to obtain a very high performance. Okay, so this is the main limitation of this architecture of vector computers. Another disadvantage of vector computers was that they were very expensive and very difficult to build. It's difficult to design and to manufacture something like that. And in fact, in the 90s, parallel computers have replaced vector computers. Okay, so this is what happened, why you can't now see that these vector computers are still used, because they were replaced by parallel computers. Okay, so parallel computer is another approach to the problem of increasing performance. Okay, so one approach we discussed is to perform vector operations. Another approach is to perform operations in parallel. Okay, so to build something that is called parallel computer, and in fact, these parallel computers can be characterized in such a way that they can simultaneously process multiple data with different instructions. Okay, so we have a situation that is different than in the case of the vector computer. We have different multiple data, so this is the same for the vector computer and for the parallel computer, but in the case of parallel computer, we have different instructions. Okay, on some data we execute some instruction, and then on some other data we execute some other instruction. This is the most important difference between vector computer and parallel computer. Okay, if we take a look at this graph, then this computer that we find here, the most powerful computers today are all parallel computers. Okay, so now we are here, and most machines that display very high computational power are the parallel computers. Okay, so now we can take a look at the parallel computer, how it is made, what is the characteristic of the parallel computer. So, in short, you can say that the parallel computer is a system of many, usually identical processing units that are working together. Okay, so this is how it looks. Typically, we have many computers which are usually identical. They are somehow combined together, and then they are able to work together. Okay, so, and the main idea that stands behind this approach about parallel computer is that it is easier in practice. If you want to produce some computer that is really powerful, so it is easy to take 100 stock computers and combine them together, rather than to manufacture, to produce one computer that is 100 times faster. Okay, so I think that's obvious. It's difficult, in fact, today to produce computer that is 100 times faster. Okay, so you know what are the frequencies, typical frequencies today of the processors, something like a 2.4 GHz or something like that, up to 3 GHz. Okay, so it's not possible to increase the frequency of the processors that are based on sliding technology even. Okay, we are at the end. Okay, people are thinking about how to replace sliding with some other material. Okay, so the basic idea, it's better to take 100 stock computers, combine them together, rather than to try to produce a computer that is 100 times faster. The solution is also cheaper, of course. Okay, so. Okay, so now I will try to characterize parallel computers, but before I will characterize this parallel computer, it is worth to show, to discuss the differences between parallel computer and distributed system. Okay, so this is also something that you can find often, but these distributed systems are completely different. Okay, so typical parallel computer is a collection of at least two processors capable of jointly solving a complex computational task. Okay, so this is the characteristics. And usually they have the same architecture, and they are usually controlled by the same operating system. Okay, so this is how a typical parallel computer looks like. Okay, so we have many processors combined together, running under the control of the same operating system. There is also something like a distributed system, something that's called the distributed system. And in this case, we have a collection of independent computers. They are also independent. They are linked together via network, and but in this case, the software may be distributed, and these computers often have different architecture and different operating system. Okay, so this is something that is completely different. In this case, we have different computers with different architecture connected together, running different software and different operating systems. In this case, we have similar machines. Okay, so, and usually, typical parallel computers, they are geographically tight, so they are situated, located in one room or in one building, and use very fast networks, like gigabit Ethernet or something that is even faster. They are linked with some dedicated networks. And typical distributed systems are usually spread geographically and linked with a slow network. Okay, so, for example, we can have desktop computers, in one desktop computer in one country, then in another country, and then you can combine them, link them together via internet and force them to work together. Okay, it will be a distributed system. Okay, so some example to show you how a typical computer look like and how a typical distributed system look like. This is an example from Poland, from my city, Gdańsk. This is in fact the computer that I am currently using, Triton computer. In fact, it is a cluster. It's located at TSK Supercomputing Center, which is in Gdańsk, Poland. And so the characteristics of the system is that we have 1,607, okay, so this is the number, two processor computers, okay, so which are called nodes. Okay, it's something like you have one main board, and then on this main board you have two processors located. Okay, so and we have 1,600 such main boards, which are called nodes. They are all combined into one parallel computer with, okay, if we multiply this number by two, we will get that we have more than 3,000 processors. Okay, so this is the number of processors. And if you account for the fact that all of these processors, they are all the same, they are Intel Xeon E5 processors, each processor possesses 12 cores, then you will get the number that in total we have more than 38,000 cores. Okay, so this is how this machine looks like. Okay, in a typical personal computer today, we have 4 cores, something like that. Okay, in this case, we have something about 40,000. Okay, cores that are able to work together. Okay, so each node, some of the characteristic, has 128 or 256 gigabytes of memory. Okay, so this is the amount of memory for each node. So if we count the total amount of the memory, operating memory, you will find that it's more than 2,000 terabytes. It's a very huge amount. And all of these nodes are linked together by InfiniBand. This is a very special, say, kind of fabric that is used in supercomputing centers, which has a very high speed, 56 gigabytes per second, and very low latency. Okay, so this is also something important. If you count what is the theoretical performance of the computer, you will find that this is more than one petaflop. Okay, in fact, this Triton computer, it was put in use in March, in previous year, in March. It was the first computer in Poland that displayed computational power bigger than one petaflop. Okay, so this is an example of a typical parallel computer. Another example, this is Tianhe 2, which is located in China. This is in fact the most powerful computer in the world right now. Okay, so it's rated first on this top 500 org list. There's a list which shows what are the most powerful computers. And in this case, the number of cores is more than 3 million. Okay, so we have 3 million cores, separate cores that are able to work together. Okay, you can run the application, at least in principle, on more than 3 million cores. Okay, so and theoretical performance is more than 50 petaflops, and the actual impact performance, because this is how in practice this performance is measured, you need to run some kind of benchmark, some kind of, in this case, impact benchmark, which performs some basic linear algebra operations and so on. Okay, so the actual performance is more than 30 petaflops. Okay, so this is the power consumption. I think that no one of you want to pay the bill for that. Okay, so and memory is also made of Intel Xeon E5 processors. Okay, so this is another example of a power computer. So we have some nodes. Each node is equipped with many processors. Each processor possesses many cores. All together, they are linked all together with some fabric, with some very with some network with very high speed, and this is how it operates. Okay, so this is how it looks. Okay, so just to show you some example of something that is completely different that I already told you, some example of a distributed system. SETI at home project is an example of the distributed system. I don't know if you have ever met that. Okay, it was popular about 10 years ago to download a kind of a screensaver, and then during the idle time of your computer, you were able to perform some calculations searching for extraterrestrial intelligence. Okay, so this is how a typical distributed system looks like. Hundreds of thousands of computers belonging to independent users, typically personal computers connected via internet, and they were all executing the same program in the idle time. Okay, so here are some numbers if you want to compare the performance of this kind of system with the performance of the typical parallel computer. You will find out that it's much less. Okay, 670 teraflops if we have more than 100,000 active users. Okay, so just to show you what are the differences. Okay, so now we can try to summarize. We can try to distinguish, we can try to find what are the typical architectures of the computers. This is something that is called Flynn's taxonomy. Okay, so we can each computer you can assign each computer to one of the four groups. Okay, so depending on how these computers process the data. Okay, so the first group is SISD. This stands for single instruction, single data, and the computers that belong to this group in each step execute one instruction on a single data. Okay, so these are typical serial computer. This is how a typical serial computer operates. Okay, on the opposite side, we have SIMD architecture, which stands for single instruction but multiple data. So in each step, we execute one instruction, the same instruction, but on many data simultaneously. Okay, so these are typical vector computers that we also discussed. Okay, so there are also different machines. We can execute many instructions, and you can execute many instructions on single data or on many data. So if we have MISD, if we execute multiple instructions on single data, then each step we execute many instructions on one datum. Okay, so this is how it looks like. For example, you have one number and then you do many different operations at the same time on this one number. Like you want to get the square of this number, and then this number to the power of 3, to the power of 4, and you get all the results at the same time. Okay, so there are this kind of computers, in fact, that are able to calculate many different values, perform many different instructions at the same time, but they are more experimental computers. They are not very common. Okay, for example, if you want to learn something, you can try to Google something about wavefront processor or something like that. Okay, these are machines that are resembling the human brain, how the human brain operates. Okay, this is something that is very extreme, in fact, extremely rare. Okay, so, and then we can also have MIMD architecture, so we can, this stands for multiple instruction, multiple data, and each step we perform many instructions are executed on many data. Okay, so this is typical. This is something that is typical to parallel computer. Okay, so we have many different cores, and each core is executing at the same time. Each core is executing different instruction and for different data. Okay, so this is something that is typical to parallel computer. We focus on this group. Okay, on this MIMD architecture. This is something that we will be talking about during the rest of this course. Okay, so just to remember, MIMD. Okay, so if we take a look at this MIMD architecture, you will find out that usually, in this case, all processors, okay, we are running some program on many processors, and usually all processors execute the same program, but the path that that each processor takes in the program depends on the number of the processor. Okay, so this is how it looks in a typical scenario, in a typical application. Okay, so in different boards, processors execute different portions of the program. Okay, so you may imagine that the structure of the program looks like that. That we have something like first we check the condition. If I am processor number one, then I process task number one. If I am processor number two, then I process task number two, and so on. Okay, so each task is different. When processing task, each processor operates on different data, performing different instructions. Okay, so you can imagine this in that way. Okay, so this is a very good look at the problem. Okay, so as I told you, from now on we will focus on these parallel computers, on this MIMD architecture, and this is how these computers may look like. Okay, so usually they are often Linux clusters, so clusters of computers that are created by joining tens of PC class computers, like in this case. So this is something that is called, in fact, Beowulf cluster. Okay, so if you take just a typical personal computer, and then you will link them with Ethernet. Okay, so then you will end up with Beowulf cluster. But you may also use some dedicated Newport and some specialized cluster software, and you will end up with something like that. Okay, so a parallel computer cluster with very high performance. Okay, but all of this fall into this category in MIMD architecture. Okay, so now we know what are the differences, what are the main approaches to the problem of processing data. Okay, so we have four different architectures. Okay, and we'll focus on this MIMD. Okay, so multiple instructions for multiple data. Okay, so another important characteristic, another important factor is the memory. Okay, so this is also something that is important. So if you want fully characterize the machine, how the machine operates, you also need to tell how the memory is organized. Okay, so this is something that is also very important. Okay, so there are in general two approaches, two classes of how the memory may be organized. So the first is something that is called shared memory. Okay, so this is one technique. So, and this is the diagram that illustrates how the system is organized. So we have many processors able to doing something, to perform some operations, but they are all connected to the same global memory. Okay, so which is shared among the processors. Okay, so each processor has access to the same data. Okay, so just directly by referring to variable and so on. Okay, so all processors have access to the same large visually operating memory, which is shared, common for all. Okay, so formally you can say in that case that all processors are said to work in the same address space. Okay, so this is the correct terminology. And what is the important feature of this architecture, of this shared memory, is that if, for example, you want to exchange some information between processors, then you may exchange this information using this memory. Okay, so if you want to pass some number from one processor to another processor, so let's say intermediate reads or something like that, then you may just put this value in the memory. Okay, so this is something that you can do on one processor, and on the other processor you may just read this value from the memory. Okay, from the same memory, because each processor is able to read and write from the same memory. Okay, so this is something that is important. Okay, and because of that, in the case of this SM architecture, the communication can be very fast. Okay, because the writing and reading from memory is very fast, and it's very easy. Okay, you don't need to do something special. Okay, you can just read some variable, some value from memory. It's not complicated. Okay, to do something like that in program. Okay, so it's very easy. Okay, so this is one approach, shared memory. You can find this kind of machines, but they are also not very popular, and they are not so powerful, because there are many difficulties that you need, many problems that you need to solve if you want to construct a very powerful shared memory system. Okay, so There are many problems. Okay, you can just to imagine. You can, if you want to realize, you can try to imagine what will happen when two processors want to read or write the same location in the memory. Or one processor wants to read and another one wants to write to that location. Okay, so which should be first? Okay, the question is. Okay, so there are some problems related to synchronization. Okay, so it's very difficult. You need to take care about the situations. Okay, so the engineering that is designing the machine needs to take care about the situations. Okay, about the synchronization. So, this is something that is very complicated, and it causes that it is very problematic to build a shared memory system that possesses many cores. Okay, so if you want to build a system that possesses more than 20 cores, it's even impossible. Okay, so you can't find shared memory systems with number of processors that is greater than 20. Okay, so but there are some, for example, I think that there are some processors with 28 cores, which has all access to the same memory, but they are so expensive that you can't afford it. Okay, so but you cannot, for example, you can have a system that possesses even 30 cores, but if you want to have a system that possesses 1,000 of cores, it's impossible. Okay, so it can be done. Okay, so we have many, in this case, we have many problems of technological nature. So specialized hardware is needed to combine these processors such that they all will have the access to the same memory. These are some solutions that are called crossover. And it's difficult to build a system that is made of more than 20 processors. Okay, so you can also imagine such a situation, okay, because of this synchronization hazards. Okay, so if you need to synchronize some memory among two processors, this is not so difficult. Okay, so because let's say that you write from one processor, then you need to check if only another processor is not trying to read from that location. Okay, but if you have thousands of processors, then this synchronization can be crucial and can dramatically decrease the performance of such a system. Okay, so this is something that is not very very common. So just to summarize. Okay, so this is something. This shared memory model is something that is very very convenient for the programmer. Okay, because if you want to exchange data between processors, you just need to use the shared memory. Okay, so there are no complications or something like that. But this is something that is in fact a nightmare for an engineer that is designing a computer. Okay, so and they are very expensive. Okay, believe me that they are very expensive. So this is one approach. We can have shared memory. Okay, so another approach is that we have distributed memory. Okay, so we have such a situation that each processor, here is a diagram that illustrates this approach. Each processor, we have many processors, possess its own memory. Okay, so which is not shared in this case, it's its own memory. Because this memory is a private, if you want, in this case, if you want to communicate, if you want to send some information, pass some information from one processor to another, then we need to use some network that is connecting these processors. Okay, so this is the second approach, distributed memory. So in this case, simply the processor is able to see only the data that is located in his own memory. Okay, if on some processor, let's say processor number, and we want to see what is in the memory of processor number N, then if these two numbers are different, then we need to do something special. Okay, we need to use this interconnection network. We need to send some message or something like that from one processor to another to be able to access different memories. So the characteristic in this case is that this is something that is very easy for the engineer. Okay, because you can just take a typical computer, okay, each processor has its own memory, and then you can just connect typical computers with some network, okay, and you will end up with this DM machine. Okay, so this is very, very easy for engineer to build, but this is very difficult for programmer. Okay, because if you want to run a program in parallel, in that case, then you need to take care of this situation where there is a need to exchange information. Okay, so this is something that is in fact crucial for this kind of machines, the exchange of the information, okay, the passing of the messages, okay, that we will be talking about. So we need in that case a way to exchange messages between processors, okay, via the network. This is something that is most important to know about this DM model. Okay, so now once we discuss different architectures and different memory models, we can focus our attention. We will be talking about this MIMD plus DM parallel process. Okay, so this is something that we will be talking about. Okay, such we have such a situation that we have many cores that process multiple different instructions at the same time, instructions that are operating on multiple data, and we have distributed memory. Okay, so this is something that we will be talking about during this course. Okay, so just to summarize, you can imagine that this MIMD, DM, parallel processing, stands for a parallel computer that is executing different instructions on each processor, processing many data simultaneously, and built with distributed memory. Okay, so, and most of the parallel computers fall into this category. Okay, if you take a look at how the situation looks today, if you go visit many different supercomputing centers, you will see that the most supercomputers are clusters, and all clusters fall into this category. Okay, so that we have many nodes connected. Each node is, in fact, a separate computer, and we have this kind of model, this kind of approach. Okay, what is important to know? Okay, before we move on, it is important to know that this kind of a parallel machine is not a monolith. Okay, so it is. You need to keep in mind that it is a kind of an ensemble of separate units, nodes, and each node has its own memory, and these nodes are linked with a network. Okay, so this is something that is important to keep in mind. And what is also important is that, of course, these nodes are unable to work on a common task until the programmer will distribute work on the nodes. And this is something that is called problem decomposition. Okay, and this is something that is also very important in the case of parallel programming. Okay, so if you want to run some program, if you want to perform some computations on a parallel computer, then we need to write this program in a very special way, accounting for this characteristic. Okay, you need to account for this parallel architecture. You need to account for this need of passing messages. Okay, if you want to exchange some information between processors, and this is something that must be explicitly coded. And we also need to account for this distribution of the work. Also, this problem decomposition must be explicitly coded in the program. Okay, so these are, in fact, two main differences between parallel programming and serial programming. Okay, first, you need to distribute the work. Okay, if you have some problem and you want to solve this problem in parallel using many processors, then you need to divide this problem into smaller problems, simply. Okay, and then tell that, okay, this processor will take care of this part of the work, this processor will take care of this part of the work, and so on. Okay, so this is the first thing that is very important. Okay, so to divide the problem into smaller sub-problems, and this is problem decomposition. Okay, so something that is crucial. And the second is that sometimes it happens that when these processors are working on this smaller task, subtasks, smaller problems, there is a need to exchange information. Okay, for example, some operation that one processor now needs to perform, I don't know, let's say that we are calculating wave function and then we need to normalize this wave function. We need to know normalization. Okay, so we can have such a situation that some operation may depend on the information that is located on the other processor. Okay, so there is a need to pass pass message to exchange information between processors. Okay, so this is the second main difference between serial processing and parallel processing. Okay, so just to give you some example, let's say that we have such a problem. Well, maybe we can make a break, because I see that we're already sitting 1 hour here, so maybe now we can, like, I think that it is a good point to have a break, for example. Okay, so let's say 2.1. Okay, so, as I told you, we'll focus on this MIMD as DM architecture. Just to remind you, what is the most important. First, we need to decompose the problem. And second, often we need to exchange the information between the processors of our file environment. Okay, so these are the, for programmer, these are two most important differences between serial programming and parallel programming. Okay, the decomposition of the problem and the communication between the processors. Okay, so just to show you how it may look in practice, some trivial example. Let's say that we have a task, and the task some problem, and the problem is that we want to add up all elements of a matrix which has 200 by 200 elements. Okay, so we have such a matrix, some elements, and now we want to sum all of these elements. Okay, so in a serial implementation, the code would look like that. Okay, so it's a kind of absurd code, of course. Okay, so what do we need to do on a serial computer? First, we need to read this matrix from a file, let's say. Okay, so if this matrix is stored in file, we need to read all of the elements, put these elements in the memory, such that in a table or array, such that we will be able to operate on it. Okay, so this is the first step. And then we can start to calculate the sum. Okay, so this part is responsible for calculating the sum. Let's say that we declare some variable, which will be the sum of all elements. And then we need one double loop, which allows us to add all the elements. Okay, so we need to loop over all rows. And then for each row, we need to loop over all columns. And for each column element, we need to add the corresponding element from this row and from this column that we are considering to the sum. Okay, so this is the pseudo code. And at the end, once we added all columns from all rows, we need to output the sum. Okay, so that we calculate. Okay, so this is how it looks, a trivial problem in serial approach. Okay, now we can try to see how it would look like if we were using parallel processing. Okay, so we have the same problem, matrix 200 by 200 elements, and now we want to do the same but in a parallel. Okay, so let's say that, just to focus our attention, we may say that we have 8 processors. Okay, so how can we deal with this problem? Okay, so the first step would be the same. Okay, we need to read the matrix from a file, so let's say that we can select one processor that will open the file, will read all elements into this processor memory. This is important. Okay, it's to its own memory. And then once we have this matrix, we can, in memory of one processor, once again, this is important, we can try to continue. Okay, so what do we need to do? First, we need to we need to divide this computational problem. Okay, so in this case, the decomposition is very, very simple. If we have matrix 200 by 200 elements, okay, so let's say that this is our matrix, square matrix, 200 elements, and 200 elements, and we have 8 processors, then we can divide the problem. Okay, the operation is very simple. We need to add all elements, so we can do something like that. We can divide this matrix into 8 parts. So this will be the part that the first processor, let's say processor number zero, will take off. This will be for processor 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, so I need to continue. Or let's say, okay, so we can divide this matrix into 8, let's say, equal parts. Okay, so it depends on the sizes of this matrix, but let's say that this is something that is often very important, that these parts that will be processed by different processors are of the equal size. Okay, that the sub-problems of the same size. Okay, so we can divide this matrix. Okay, it doesn't matter, for example, if we decompose using column index or row index, it doesn't matter in this problem. So we can divide this matrix, which has 200 by 200 elements, into eight submatrices, each with 25 by 200 elements. Okay, something like that. If we divide 200 by 8, then we get 25. So we can do it in that way. Okay, so what do we need to do then? Since this information about the matrix is available for us only one processor knows how this matrix looks like, we need to send the information about this matrix. Okay, so, and we can use such an approach that for each process, we will send just the part that this process is interested in. Okay, we don't need to send the entire matrix to all processes, okay, because each process will process a different part of this matrix. So we can just send this part of the matrix that the process is interested in. Okay, so once we split the matrix into 8 smaller parts, we can send one part to each processor. Okay, so this is requirement of the communication. Okay, so this the second important thing that this differs parallel programming from serial programming. Okay, first, as I told you, as we discussed, is the problem decomposition. This is something that we already discussed for this problem. And the second is the communication. Okay, in this case, we need to send the input data. Okay, so because we read the data only on one processor. Okay, so we send one part to each processor, and then we can start to we can continue. We can perform the computations. Okay, so in this case, each processor will calculate the sum of the elements, but only for the part that belong to this processor, simply. Okay, so we have, in this case, okay, so algorithm would be very similar, okay, but here would have for all, let's say, my rows and for all my columns. Okay, so this is the only difference. The algorithm would be very similar. Okay, so each process would add the elements that belong to its part of the matrix. And then once we calculated these sums on each processor, this is something that is done in parallel, of course. Okay, so at the same time, all processes are working, but on their parts. And once we calculated on each processor this sub-sum, then we can try to combine these results together. So if you want to know the sum of all elements, once again, we need to communicate because we need to send the sub-sums, partial sums, to one process, and then on this one process, we need to add these sums obtained from 8 processors. Okay, so this is how it would look like in the case when we were using a parallel approach. Okay, so this is very simple example, but it illustrates what does problem decomposition means and what does communication means. Okay, so you see that these two aspects are very important. Okay, so we need to divide the entire task, and we need to communicate some information, like our input data or output results. Okay, so this is something that is very important. Okay, this is something that mostly distinguishes serial and parallel programming. Okay, so now let's move to, once you have the idea about the differences, we can focus on the problem of problem decomposition. Okay, so formally, problem decomposition means dividing one large task into a set of many smaller tasks. Okay, so this is what we need to do. This is what problem decomposition means. And what is important is that the computers are unable to do it automatically, of course. Okay, you can't just for example, using the Amos functions in a programming language like a decomposed problem. Okay, so this kind of abstraction and so on. Okay, so this is something that we are responsible of. Okay, so we, the programmers, must decompose the problem on our own so that it is ready for parallel processing. Okay, so and there are, in general, three different approaches to the problem of problem decomposition. Okay, three different, completely different strategies. Three different ways how we can tackle problem decomposition. And here are the names of these approaches. The first is trivial decomposition. Okay, so this word trivial suggests something. Okay, so that this is a very easy one. In fact, one that we already discussed. Okay, I will tell you something more about this. The second one is functional decomposition. Okay, so, and the last one is data decomposition, and here we can define some subclasses. We can use geometric data decomposition, scattered spatial data decomposition, or we can use task farm approach. Okay, these are the main strategies to the problem decomposition, and it's important to know. Okay, so such that there are such approaches. You don't need to invent anything from scratch. Okay, if you want to make your problem parallel ready, you need to take a look at the problem and think about which strategy it would be good to use in that case. Okay, so accounting for the characteristic of your problem. Okay, so this is something that is important. Okay, now I will try to discuss all of these approaches just to give you some, let's say, more general informations about how it can be tackled, the problem of problem decomposition. Okay, and we just quickly went through all of these approaches. So the first one, trivial decomposition. So as I said, and as this word suggests, trivial, this is the easiest one. Okay, so, and it can be applied if the data can be divided into independent parts, and each of these parts can be treated with the same algorithm. Okay, if you have such a situation, that in parallel your problem is the same in fact, and the algorithm is the same, but the only difference is that you run this algorithm for some part of the data only, then you can always use trivial decomposition. Okay, so this is what trivial decomposition means. Okay, so example, add up all elements of a 200 by 200 matrix. Okay, so this example that we discussed is an example when you can use this trivial decomposition. Okay, so you can also use different type of decompositions, but in this case, it's very easy to solve this problem with trivial decomposition. Okay, so in different ports, in trivial decomposition, each processor gets a portion of the data to compute and takes care of it. Okay, so this is how it looks. And what is important is that there are no dependencies, so the processors do not need to communicate. Okay, so the only part when there is a meet of the communication is the beginning and the end of the communications, when we need to communicate, when we need to distribute the data, the input data for the computations, and we need to collect the results at the end, okay, from the computations. Okay, there are no other dependencies and there are no other needs to communicate between the processors. Okay, so this is something that is very, very typical that for the trivial decomposition. There is no need to communicate, okay, when working on sub-problem. Okay, so what is important in this case is that the total time that we need to compute. Okay, so when we are solving this problem in parallel, is determined by the time that we need to process the largest part. Okay, subpart. We divided our problem into subproblems. Okay, so all of these problems, subproblems, are solved in parallel. So each all processes are working simultaneously on these parts, and the time that we need to finish the entire problem is determined by let's say by the largest part of the subpart of our problem. Okay, so it's often useful, important to divide the subproblem into the parts that have the same size. Okay, so if you divide, for example, this problem in such a way that you will have, for example, for one processor, you will assign submatrix with 100 by 200 elements, and for the other processor, smaller parts, then you will have to wait for the processor that got the biggest part. Okay, so that's obvious. Okay, so this is something that is important and that is very important, in fact, in parallel programming. This is something that is called load balancing. Okay, so this is a very important term, so maybe I will write it. Load balancing. Okay, so in that case, it's very easy to balance the load. Okay, so we have just two numbers that define the size of the problems, the number of rows and the number of columns. So it's very easy to divide it such that each part will be of the same size. But there are some problems where this load balancing is more complicated. Okay, so later I will tell you a few words about it. This is very important. Okay, so you can imagine such a situation that you have, for example, a very large matrix, okay, and if you, let's say, something was realized wrong in your code and so on, such that one processor got a very huge matrix part and the other very small, then in such a situation you are simply just wasting the computational power, okay, because the program is running in parallel, the program is running on all processors. One processor is computing this large part, and the other already finished and they are waiting for this processor. Okay, you are just wasting the computational power. This is something that is important. Okay, so this trivial decomposition, it occurs quite frequently. Okay, if you decide to work in future in this area, you will see that this approach to the problem decomposition can be used very frequently. I can give you some other examples. One example is numerical integration, something like that, such that we have some function and we need to calculate a definite integral. Okay, so a definite integral of some function f of x from a to b. Okay, so the approach in this case is very simple. Okay, if you want to do it in parallel, you can just divide this definite integral into smaller definite integrals and then assign each sub-integral to the processor. Okay, so simply we have something like that, just to write it formally. Okay, we have, let's say that we have integral from a to b, function f of x over dx, and the approach is that we divide this, we write this as integral from a to, let's say, which symbol?
A1, A2.
A1, probably. Okay, fx, bx. Maybe I will change. Okay, so this is ai initial and this is af final. Okay, now it's better. So from a initial to a1, plus then we have the second integral from a1 to a2, f of x, bx, plus, okay, and so on, from a2 to a3. And the last element would be to AF, A final. Okay, so the composition here is determining this the location of this intermediate points. Okay, so this is something that is trivial, for example, and we can tackle this problem in such a way that we can divide the entire range into sub-ranges with equal size, and then in each sub-range we can calculate this definite integral normally, okay, using some numerical methods like boxes and so on. Okay, so just numerical integration. Okay, so another typical application of this trivial decomposition is Monte Carlo technique. Okay, if you are solving, I think that because Professor Magnoni told me that you were discussing Monte Carlo method, right? Okay, so I think that you know something about this technique.
We have not discussed yet, but will be the subject of the last part of the course.
Okay. So we can keep in mind that this fits almost ideally to Monte Carlo. Okay, so these are some techniques that are based on random numbers and generate some sequence of random numbers and the new platform, important something and so on. And this trivial decomposition fits almost ideally to Monte Carlo. Okay, so we'll also try something. Okay, so tomorrow there will be some examples. We will do some computer exercises. We'll spend all 3 hours on coding. Okay, I will show you how to write computer programs for all the important aspects and so on. Where you can make some mistake and something like that. And then there will be one problem related to Monte Carlo, and I will show you that it can be done, in fact. Okay, so this is the first type of the decomposition, trivial decomposition, a very easy one, okay, and occurs quite frequently, and we just summarize, divide the problem into subproblems, and each subproblem can be solved with the same algorithm. Okay, so this is trivial decomposition. The second approach is functional decomposition. Okay, and as the name suggests, this time we divide the problem based on the functions that we are performing on that problem. Okay, so simply we are dividing not the data but the algorithm. Okay, so if the problem can be divided into some separate stages, that first you perform something, and then you perform something, and then you perform something, so different kind of operations, then you can take each operation and assign this operation to a different processor. Okay, so this is how it looks. Okay, so just to give you some examples, something that illustrates how this functional decomposition works, we can imagine that we have, let's say, a guitar factory. Okay, so guitar factory, and let's say that the production of one single guitar can be divided, each guitar can be divided into 5 stages. Okay, first we need to create the guitar body, then we need to add tuning knobs at the end of the guitar, then we need to paint this guitar body, we need to put on strings, and then tune the guitar. Okay, so we have this kind of stages. Okay, so of course, we cannot, for example, add tuning knobs before the guitar body was created. Okay, so it means that we need to directly go with one guitar through all of the stages. Okay, so how can we decompose this problem? Okay, so in a guitar factory, you can decompose, let's say that you have to produce many such guitars, and each guitar must pass through all of the stages. You can do something like that. You can assign one person to each stage. Okay, so you can tell that one worker will create guitar bodies, always, only. Okay, so this will be his task. Okay, all the life he will be just creating these guitar bodies. One, then another one, and so on. Okay, so another guy will be adding tuning knobs, and so on. Okay, so you can assign to each stage one person, and then you can use pipelining. Okay, so this is something that is called pipelining, that you just create one worker, create guitar body. Once he finished creating this guitar body, he gives this guitar body to the second worker, and the second worker is adding tuning knobs. Okay, once he finished, he's passing this guitar to the next section, and so on. Okay, so this is how the data propagates. Okay, you can think about the guitar as a data. Okay, and the data must propagate through all of these stages. Okay, so this is something that is called pipelining. Each guitar must go through all 5 stages before it's finally produced. And we can use the same approach, the same concept in the case of a program. Okay, if we have such a problem that we can divide it into different stages. Okay, like let's say that we have some example that we are processing some image. Okay, so this is not an example taken from physics, but it's over from programming. We have some image that we want to process, we want to smooth this image, then we want to extract features of this image. We want to recognize objects and then display as some scene or some objects. Then we can do the same. Okay, we can assign to each of this stage different processor, and each processor will take care of different stage. Okay, so this is another approach. Okay, we are not dividing the data, but we are dividing the program, the functions that we are realizing, that we are performing in our program. Okay, so what is important here is that low balancing may be difficult to achieve in this kind of processing. Okay, so if some section takes a lot of time, more time than the others, then you might find such a situation that your data is stuck in at that section. Okay, so let's say that this smoothing takes a lot of time. Okay, you get the first image, put it, one processor takes care of the smoothing, and the other three sections are waiting. Simply, they are not doing anything. They are just wasting computational power. Okay, so this is something that is important. Okay, so and you will always find something like that. So the load balancing may be more difficult in that case, but there are some solutions that you can use in order to balance this kind of computations. For example, if some section is computationally demanding, then you may assign a larger number of workers. Simply, okay. So you can also take a look at the problem like on so the four separate problems, and then within one section you may also decompose the problem simply. Okay. So if it takes, for example, let's say smoothing takes 4 hours. Feature extraction, object recognition, and display takes 1 hour each stage. Okay, so if you want to balance it, then you may assign 4 workers here, and to other sections, one worker only. Okay, and it will get very fluently. Okay, you will have such a situation when the problem will be balanced. Okay, so this is the second approach to the problem decomposition, functional decomposition. In physics, it's difficult to give some example of this kind of decomposition, because in physics, when you are, for example, using some particle methods like molecular dynamics and so on, mostly the data decomposition fits the best to the problem. Okay. So I use the term of the data decomposition, but I didn't explain what does it mean. So now the last approach to the problem decomposition, the data decomposition. Okay, so this is another type of the problem decomposition method, technique. And this time we are not dividing the algorithm, but we are just decomposing the data. Okay, simply. Okay, so we need to distribute the input data among the processors. Okay, so what is important here is that in this case, the dependencies may be present. Okay, so this is something that distinguishes data decomposition from the trivial decomposition. There may be some dependencies between the data, and there is a need to communicate. Okay, in that case, in general. Okay, so just to give you some example. Example taken from physics, from molecular dynamics. I don't know if you've discussed molecular dynamics, so you know how this method looks like. Okay, so what do? That we define some system of particles, atoms, specified positions, and then we are trying to find the time evolution of such a system. We need to describe the interactions and perform numerical integration of the equation of motion. Okay, just in short. Okay, how the molecular dynamics method works. Okay, so the most demanding part of the molecular dynamics is the evaluation of the forces. I think that you know that. Okay, so that often when you are trying to describe, especially some complicated systems with covalent bonding, for example, and so with metal bonding, then the evaluation of forces, the form of the potential is such complicated that the time of the more than 90% of the total time of the computation is just the evaluation of the forces. Okay, so. And here is an example how we can do it in parallel. For example, let's say that in molecular dynamics, once you know the positions of all atoms, you need to calculate the forces between all pairs of atoms. Okay, sometimes Kappa-Frag is introduced such that we are interested in forces between particles that are separated by less than some specified value, but let's say in general, we are interested in forces between all particles. Okay, so how can we decompose this problem? Okay, we can apply something what is called geometric data decomposition, and we can divide the system. This is simulation box. Okay, we can divide the system into some parts according to some geometric criteria. Okay, like introduced to planes, and then assign particles that are located in one quarter to one processor, the particles that are located in the second quarter to the second processor, and so on. Okay, so this is what can we do. And then we can solve the problem of computing all the forces in such a way that the processor will take care only of particles that belongs, that are located within his path. Okay, simply. Okay, so if processor see that the particle is located within his path, then this processor is calculating the forces between this particle and all other particles. Okay, and we do the same for the all particles and all processors. This is how this problem can be decomposed. What is important here is that there is a need of communication, as I told you. Okay, so in a typical implementations of the molecular dynamics, you have such a information that on one processor, you just store the information about the positions of the particles that belongs to that processor. Okay, you don't have the information about the position of the other particles. Okay, and if you have such a situation that some particle is located within the interface, okay, near the interface of two processors, then you need to exchange the information. Okay, processor number 4 knows the position of that particle, of this particle, but doesn't know the position of this particle and this particle. Okay, if you want to calculate the force, you need to calculate the distance between particles of interest, and then based on that distance you calculate the force. Okay, so there is a need to exchange the information. Okay, so once when calculating the force acting on that particle, this processor number 4 needs to exchange the information with processor number 2 and processor number 3. Okay, so this is what is important, and this is something that distinguishes this data decomposition from trivial decomposition, the need of exchanging information. Okay, so this is something that is really important. In parallel processing, this is often a bottleneck of parallel processing. Okay, so if you, for example, implement your algorithm in such a way that there is a large amount of communication, you will see that the performance of your algorithm is very low. Okay, so this is because of the physical limitation. The communication takes time. Okay, whenever you are running on a computer, a typical computer on cluster, the communication always takes time. Okay, you need to send some information from one processor to another processor, and this takes time. Okay, you need to prepare network. This corresponds to some latency, and then you need to transfer data. Okay, so this is something that may be crucial. Okay, so people are always trying to decompose the problem in such a way that the amount of the communication will be minimal. Okay, so this is often very important. Okay, so we may also look at this data decomposition from the other side. We may try to discuss the problem of load balancing. Of course, in this case, load balancing can be characterized by specifying the number of particles. Okay, we want to have such a situation that that the numbers of particles that belong to different processors are the same. Okay, so maybe it would be better to divide this box in a different way. Okay, this is how the load balancing can be achieved in that way, in the case of the data decomposition, geometric data decomposition. Okay, so this is something that is important. Okay, we don't want to have such a situation that, for example, you run the simulation for a system that is made of millions of atoms, and one processor takes care of 900,000 atoms, and the other takes care for smaller amount numbers of atoms. Okay, so this is something that is important in that case. Okay, so this is something that I already explained. I think, right? So just to repeat, so that you will be such that you will remember. When calculating the force between atoms assigned to the same processor, there is no problem, okay, because we know the positions of two particles that belong to that particular processor, and when we are calculating the force between atoms assigned to different processors, a communication must take place. because the particles reside in different memories. Okay, and we need to communicate is what distinguishes the data decomposition from the trivial decomposition. Okay, so this is the most important factor. In fact, there are two different approaches, because I just put one data decomposition here, but there are two different approaches to data decomposition. The first one is geometrical one that we already described. We have data decomposition. Okay, you can have such a situation that you use some geometric criterion to divide the problem, to decompose the problem. And the second approach is known as scattered spatial decomposition. In which the data may be scattered spatially. Okay, sometimes it happens that it is better to use this approach. Okay, you don't have to use this geometrical decomposition. Okay, data decomposition means just divide the data. Okay, and the way that you will take it is up, depends on you. Okay, you may use some geometric criteria, and you will end up with geometrical data decomposition, but you may also use some different criteria, and you will end up with scattered spatial decomposition. Okay, in some problems, this may be better. Okay, there is no requirement to use geometric criteria. Okay, so this is important. Okay, so another approach to also to data decomposition is task file. This is the last one. This is also a way to decompose the problem. And also we are decomposing the data. We are decomposing the problem by decomposing data. But in this case, we do something that is completely different. Okay, so task file. Okay, so how to explain that? Here's a picture that explains the idea. Okay, so we have an approach that is closely related to the master-slave concept. Okay, so let's say that we have n processors, and we divide all processes into two groups, masters and slaves. Okay, I think that the name explains everything. Okay, so master doesn't do anything, just guiding how the workers work, and workers, slaves, they are working. Okay, so in the simplest case, in the simplest scenario, there is one master and the other processes are slaves, are workers. Okay, so and how this method works? What do we do? First, master needs to split the computational problem into smaller problems, into smaller tasks. Okay, so you can imagine that this is the entire problem, and the master divides this problem into smaller tasks called grains. Okay, each such a small subtask is called grain, and then he puts these grains into the pool of grains to process. Okay, so we have problem divided into small problems that needs to be processed. All of them needs to be processed if you want the entire problem to be processed. Okay, so we divided the problem, and then this operates in such a way that each of the worker, until all work is done, until all grains are processed, do the following things. First, ask the master to assign him a grain of work. So he comes to the master, ask him if there is something to do, and if master says that there is something to do, then master assigns him some grain, and then the slave takes this grain and processes it. Okay, so this is how it works. And once the slave processes this grain, he returns to the master and repeats everything. Ask if there is something else to do, ask for work, and do the same. Okay, so of course, when returning to the master, he returns also the results that he obtained by processing this grain. This is also something important. But this is how this approach works. Okay, you have one master that divides the entire problem, and slaves, workers that processes the problem. This is another approach to the problem decomposition. It is very important, because it is especially important if you have a problem that you can divide into smaller parts, but you cannot predict how much time it will take to process one part. Okay? You divide it, let's say you have some data, you divide this data into smaller parts of equal size, but the processing of each part may take time that can be completely different. Okay, so for example, there are many such examples, I think. Why it is a good solution for this kind of problem? You can imagine that we have such a situation. Okay, just some pictorial view of this approach, why it is very good. One, let's say this is our problem, and we divided this problem into smaller subproblems, grains. Okay, this is one grain, some input data, some numbers, and based on these numbers we do something. Okay, we calculate something, for example, I don't know, some integral with some accuracy and so on. And it may happen that the time that is needed to process data can be completely different. Okay, let's say that this grain, it takes one process, 1 hour to process, okay, to complete. And also for this one, something like a 1 hour, 2 hours, 1 hour, 3 hours, one, two. But there is, for example, some grain which takes 300 hours, okay? So some example, you can think about it. Let's say that you can that you have to calculate some integral numerically. When you divide the entire range of the interest into smaller parts, okay, and here you have such a situation that the function is very smooth. Okay, also here you have such a situation that the function is very smooth, and here you have such a situation that the function varies very strongly. Okay, so here you can calculate this integral by dividing, let's say, this sub-interval into 10 sub-intervals or something like that, okay? But in this part, you need more intervals, sub-intervals, okay? So this will take more to process, of course, okay? So if you have this kind of problem, then task part is a very good approach if you don't know how much it will take to process one grain, because if you have many grains, okay, so let's say that one worker will take this grain that takes 300 hours to process, and he will be processing this grain for 300 hours. Okay, but the others will process one grain which will take 1 hour, another one which will take 1 hour, and maybe one which will take 2 hours, and so on. But if the amount, if the number of the grains is large enough, then you can always find something to do for that worker. Okay, so this can be very easily balanced. Okay, it will balance automatically, in fact. Okay, one worker will spend a lot of time on one grain, but the other one will spend the same amount of time, but within this time will process larger number of grains. Okay, so in this case, if you have such a situation, then this will be self-balancing, in fact. Okay, so in the limit, when the number of grains goes to the infinity, you will get the ideal load balancing always. Okay, so this is something that is going in fact by the central theorem.
It is also ideal for distributed processing because you have a very different processor.
Yeah, that's so right. Yeah, this is also important. If you have a problem, as Professor mentioned, and we are using distributed processing such that you are processing the same problem on different machines, but machines with different capabilities, okay, then you can also use this approach. Okay, you don't know the speed of the machine, you don't know how long it will take, okay, for that machine. One processor may process this grain within 1 hour, the other one may spend 2 days on that, okay, with this very slow processor. Okay, so this is also good for distributed processing when you don't know you don't have a priori the information about the processing capabilities of the machines. Okay, so this is the last approach to the problem of the problem decomposition task file. And just to summarize, few words. Probably the composition is essential. Okay, if you want to solve some problem in parallel, first step that you need to take is to decompose the problem. You need to think about how to decompose it and how to decompose it such that it will be balanced. Okay, so this is something that is important. Okay, so we are responsible for doing this, of course. This is something that cannot be done by computer automatically. However, there are some compilers, for example, that are able to decompose simple problems. Okay, but these are different kind of technologies. We will be not talking about this. And there are many different ways to decompose the problem. Three main approaches: trivial decomposition, functional decomposition, and data decomposition. Okay, within data decomposition, we have three sub-approaches: geometric, scattered spatial, and task-far. Okay, so what is also important is that some problems may be tackled by a combination of different decomposition strategies. Okay, you can decompose the problem using functional decomposition. If you see that some stage is more computationally demanding, then you may decompose this stage, sub-stage, decompose the stage into sub-stages using some different strategy to the problem decomposition. Okay, so they can be also combined. Okay, so this is something that is also important. Okay, so and this is the last slide, in fact, for the first part. The general ideas. Okay, so the general problems of parallel processing. I think that now we have some idea about what are the problems, what is important, how parallel computers differ from the typical serial computers, and what does it mean to decompose the problem, and why there is a need to communicate, okay, and in this MIMD plus DM architecture. Okay, now we will move to this message passing interface, which allows you to write a parallel program. This is a library, a standard, in fact, that can be used to very easily write a parallel program. Now I will tell you a few words about this library, about the history of this library, and about functions. Okay, so in fact, this message passing interface, MPI, this is how it is called, is a library, and it is also standard. Okay, so this is something that is standardized. Okay, so some people at the beginning of the 90s, the situation looked in such a way that the parallel computers, they became very popular. Okay, so what was problematic was that every manufacturer of the parallel computer supported their own solution, okay, to the problem of parallel computing. Okay, so different manufacturers, different solutions that allowed you to write a computer program. Okay, so this was something really problematic, because if you wrote a program for one parallel computer, then you cannot just take this program and move this program to another parallel computer produced by different manufacturer. Okay, so because the solutions that were used were completely different. Okay, so people were thinking about this problem, and the companies of course, this resulted in chaos and so on. There were many problems such that you couldn't perform computations in different supercomputing centers with the same software. And at the end of the 93, the companies like IBM, Intel, Express, P4, I think that these two are very well known. These two are not so well known, but these are also some computer companies. They propose a draft of a new standard for message passing. Okay, so this is something that is important in the case of parallel processing message passing. Okay, so how to pass the information from one process to another. Okay, so and they propose a new standard, which was called message passing interface. This is a standard, well-known standard. It is well documented, well tested. This is important. If you want to learn something about the standard, something more, because I will discuss just the basics on how to use the standard, how to use this library, there is a MPID content reference which describes this standard. You can find this book in this location. Okay, so it can be downloaded from the network for free. This is the entire description of the entire standard. Few words about features of this MPI. So this is something that is standardized and that is portable. Okay, it means that you can when you wrote a program using MPI, then you can just take this program, move through this program to another computer, parallel computer, and you will be able to compile this program and run it also on different computer, even with different architecture. Okay, so this is something that is very important. It often happens that we perform some computations at some supercomputing center, so some calculations, difficult simulations in physics or something like that. Then you realize that you need more computational power, because, for example, you cannot solve this problem with 100 cores, because you will need to run this for 10 months. And you think about some other supercomputing center which has machine which has more than 10,000 cores, and you take the program and move to the another supercomputing center. Okay, if you wrote the program using MPI, it will be not a problem to move with your program to another. This is in fact in standard today. Okay, so in more than 99% parallel programs are written using MPI. You can trust me. Okay, I am working actively in this area, and more than 99% of programs are written using MPI. And in each supercomputing center, on each cluster, MPI is installed already. Okay, you can just use it. Compilers of this library. This library is available. You don't need to do anything. You can just come and use it. Okay, it was designed by a group of researchers from academia and industry. This is something that is important. This means that this standard is well suited for scientific purposes. Okay, so there are many functions available that are especially useful in scientific computations. Okay, so this is something that is important. And as I told you, this MPI functions on a wide variety of parallel computers. There are many manufacturers, Intel, IBM, and many others, and for all these machines, MPI is available. Okay, not depending on the architecture, you can always use MPI. What it is MPI? So in fact, it is a standard. So it defines the syntax and the semantics of code of library routines. Okay, so you can think about this MPI library as some set of functions that you can use within a program. Okay, to exchange the information between the processors. Okay, and the standard defines the syntax of these functions, so the arguments, the syntax, and so on, and also defines the semantics of this function. So it strictly defines how these functions should work, how they should behave. Okay, so this is something that needs to be satisfied. So the standard defines how the any implementation of this MPI library will behave. Okay, all implementation behave in the same way. Okay, if something is defined in the standard, then it will behave not depending on the implementation. Okay, it allows to write portable message passing programs. This is important in different computer languages. This is also something that is important. There are implementations of this MPI available for many different programming languages, like a Fortran, for Fortran 77, even for Fortran 90 also. For C, there is an MPI available. Also for C++, there is an object-oriented even implementation of the MPI for C++. Okay, so these are the most popular languages, so I think that it is enough. It's also available for Java, even. Okay, so for scientists, they are not using Java. Obviously. Okay, so this is not for scientific computations. Okay, so what is also important to know is that there are several well-tested and efficient implementations. Okay, so the standard just defines how the functions should work. okay, how the functions should work, how you should call these functions, what is the syntax, semantics of the functions. Okay, it doesn't tell anything on what is inside. Okay, so, and there are many different implementations. Okay, so of the standard, the most popular is OpenMPI, which is public. You can just download it, it's for free, it's in the public domain. Okay, so OpenMPI, there is also Intel MPI, implementation of MPI designed by Intel. This is very efficient, highly efficient. Okay, if you are performing some computations on a cluster which has Intel processors and so on, it is always a good idea to have Intel MPI. Okay, you need to pay for it, it's very expensive, but in most computer centers, this Intel MPI is available. Okay, so computer centers are buying licenses and so on, such that you can also use this implementation. Okay, there is also MPIC, another implementation which was very popular in past, and there is also MPT, something like the MPT library. On some machines you can find, especially on machines produced by SGI, Stephen Graphics Interactive. I don't know if you heard about this company. This is also some manufacturer from some company from computer industry. They are also producing some very, very powerful machines, especially machines with shared memory, in fact. Okay, so SGI. There is also MPT. Okay, if you see that you have MPT, it means that it's also MPI, in fact, MPI standard. Okay, and there are also some other, but these are the most important implementations of the MPI library. Okay, now, few words about the characteristics of the MPI. Okay, so how does it look in practice? So in practice, it looks in that way that the program, if you want to write a program that is parallel ready, you just use a typical unmodified programming language. Okay, if you learn C or C++, but for them you don't have to learn anything about language. Okay, so MPI is not modifying programming language. The programming language is the same. Okay, the constructions used within the language are the same. They are not modified. Okay, so MPI provides some special functions that are used to. In fact, MPI provides some special functions that are used to communicate between, to perform communications, and these functions are provided as a library. Okay, so you can just in program you can just include some library. Like you include, I don't know, in C, some mathematical libraries and so on, and then you can just call these functions within your program to transfer data, information between processors. Okay, so there is no difference, no significant difference between a typical serial programming and programming with MPI. Okay, so for programmer, it means you need to include one library, simply. Okay, and then use functions of this library. What is important is that since we are talking about this MIVM approach, okay, so this is the architecture for which this MPI is designed, especially, then it means that all variables are local, okay, that are they are visible only for a single processor. Okay, so we have this kind of approach. So parallel program means running different programs on different processors and performing communication between processors. And in this approach, all variables are local. They are only visible on the processors. Okay, so this is something that is important. So we need to communicate. We need to exchange some information between processors. Okay, so the characteristic of the MPI, of the program written in MPI. The program has to be written in a special way. And in the most common case, in fact, each process, you write one program, which you later run on many processors. Okay, so the same program running on many processors. And the only difference is that the path we go through the program depends on the processor number. Okay, so you can Within MPI, you can get the processor number, a very unique identifier of the processor, and then depending on the processor number, you can perform different operations. Okay, so this is how it looks in practice in programming. Okay, so we have one program, one single program, all processor, each processor runs the same program, but the processors are assigned to groups, different groups, maybe groups, and the path. The branch of the program depends on the processor number. Okay, so this is how it looks in practice. Okay, so and within MPI, when you write a program in MPI, then you may distinguish processors using identifiers. In MPI, the processors are distinguished using something what is called rank. And something like that, rank. For each processor, you write a program using MPI parallel program, then you start this program on many processors, and on each processor is given a unique number, which is called rank. Okay, if you run, the convention is that if you run the program on n processors, there is a mistake there. If we run on n processors, then this rank can be 0, 1, 2, up to n prods minus 1. Okay, so each processor knows this number, its own, his rank, and then you can use this rank within the program. Okay, so you can write a program in which the path will depend on this rank number. Okay, there is a mistake here. It should be minus 1, okay, because of that. Typical convention, but we start the numbering with 0. Okay, so in fact, okay, you need to keep in mind this is something important also that because I said that all processors run the same program, they run the same program in a typical applications of the MPI, but the path they go through in the program depends on the processor number. Okay, so this is how it looks. Okay, so and you may also look at this MPI from different side. In fact, this MPI library is a kind of an interface layer that lies between communication network and processes. Okay, so let's say that this is our parallel machine. It may be cluster composed of many processors, many cores, and then they are working. We are running the same program on all processes, on all processors, and there is a need to exchange information, and the MPI defines it is an interface layer between processors and communication network. Okay, this is very, very useful, very convenient in practice because you don't need to know anything about communication network. Okay, if you run the same, if you want to write a parallel program, you just need to know the MPI standard. You don't need to know any details about communication network, how it works, okay, what kind of network it is. It is Ethernet or some other more efficient network with higher speed and so on. Okay, so you don't need to know anything about this. Okay, you just need to know this MPI standard. Okay. So, this is just some introduction to the MPI. So, it is used, as the name suggests, as I told you, this is the interface for message passing. Okay, so it allows you to perform communication, to communicate some information between processors. Okay, so, if you want to talk about the communication, if you want to talk about exchanging messages, first we need to tell a few words how the message in MPI is constructed. Okay, how the message looks like. Okay, so in fact, message is a packet of data traveling between processors. This is what can we say about message. Okay, so this is what it is, message in fact. And in MPI, the message has a structure that is similar to a letter or a fax. Okay, so each message possess many fields, okay, which defines some different information, and we have first, the data that we are sending. Okay, so this is one part of each message. So each message contains some data. And we have also some envelope, some kind of header that contains information about this message that are required to pass that message to a proper recipient. Okay, so this is also something important. So we have information who sent that message, to whom this message was sent, and some other information. Okay, so not only the data. So each message contains the following data. The first is sender ID. Okay, so this is just the number of the processor sending the message. Okay, we are sending some message from one processor to another, and each message possesses information about which processor sent that message. Okay, so sender ID. The second information is the type of the data sent. Okay, so what do we have inside the envelope? The type of the data. Okay, so it can be we can send different data of different type. We can send integer numbers, characters, or floating point numbers. Okay, this is also something that is defined, that each message defines. Okay, the type of the data that we are sending. There is also information about the number of elements. You may want to send one integer number, but you may also want to send 100 integer numbers. Okay, so there is also information about the number of the elements that we has, that the message contains. Okay, and there's also recipient ID, so the number of the processor that will receive this message. And the last information, which is very useful, very often, each message is also equipped with an identifier, which is called tag. Okay, so you may think about it as about as user-defined number that lets us, that lets you to distinguish messages from another. Okay, you can, for example, send a message and tell that this is message with number 100. Okay, or send some other message and tell that this is message number 200. Okay, and then you may distinguish these messages using this identifier, which is called tag. Okay, so this is also something that is important. Okay, so to summarize, once again, we have information who sent that message, to whom this message is traveling. We have the information about the data type, so what do we have inside the envelope, what kind of data are these integer numbers, characters, or floating point numbers of single precision or double precision. And we have number of elements that the message contains, and also unique identifier of message, which is called tag. Okay, so this is how the message within MPI is constructed. Okay, so this is the first important term, message. The second important term is communicator. Okay, this is also something that is called communicator within MPI. And you may think about of communicator as of a kind of group. Okay, so by default, okay, we run some program in parallel on some number of processors, and then we may define some subset of these processors. Okay, so we can, for example, separate some task group, okay, and then we can exchange messages within this subgroup. Okay, so there is also something that is called communicator. So in different words, we can assign processors to groups, which are called communicators. And what is important is that all message, when you are performing, when you are sending or trying to receive message, all messages are transmitted within communicator. Okay, when we are sending message or when you are trying to receive message, you need to define the communicator for which that action is performed. Okay, so this is important. Okay, so this allows us to send messages not only to all the processors that we are working with, but also to a subset of all processors if we wish to do something like that. Okay, so this is important. And what is also important is that by default, there is one special communicator which is always available. When you write a program, this communicator is always available. It's called MPI com world, which means MPI common world, the entire world, and this communicator groups all the processes. Okay, so this is the entire group that you are, all processes that you are working with. Okay, so let me see. Just one question: how much time do we have still?
Well, depends on them. How much tired are they?
Are you tired? Because I think that this is a good point to stop. Maybe just one more slide. Okay, so this is all something general, and then we have something strictly speaking about the functions that are available within MPI. So a few words about transmitting messages. Okay, so MPI allows you to send some information, to exchange information between processors. And there are two different methods, ways of doing that. Okay, so the first is blocking method, blocking send, and second is non-blocking send. Okay, they are completely different. Okay, so we'll talk only about blocking transmission. Non-blocking transmission is more complicated. There are some problems that are related to non-blocking transmission. So the difference is that in the case of the blocking send, in the case of the blocking transmission, the sender holds until the message is sent. Okay, so we send some information. Okay, if you send from one processor some information to another, then the sender waits until the confirmation will be returned that this message was in fact received by the second processor. Okay, so this is important. Okay, so the process is not doing anything; it's just after sending is waiting for the confirmation. Okay, so this is how the first kind of this of the communication method work. The second is non-blocking send. And in this case, the sender does not need to hold until the message is received. He might initiate the send, perform some computation while the message is transmitted. This is important. Okay, we are not waiting for the confirmation until the transmission will end, until the confirmation will return. But we may perform some computations while the message is transmitted, and then check if it has been received later, simply. Okay, so this is non-blocking. So the analog is that in the first case we have something like a telephone conversation when we always have some information from the other side. Okay, yeah, I got it, and so on. And here we have the analog, maybe sending email. You may send email, and then later you may come and check if this email was received. Okay, if there is some return. Some information was returned. Okay, so this is something that is important, that we have two different ways of communication. Also something that is also important, but I didn't put it here, now I see, is that all communication methods can be divided also according to some other criteria. Okay, so which we can divide all transmission methods into two groups. The first is point-to-point communication. Point-to-point communication. Okay, when we have just one sender and one receiver. Okay, so one processor that sends the information and one processor that receives the information. Okay, so this is sender, this is receiver. Point to point, one point on one side and one point on this in the second side. Okay, and the second group is collective communication. Okay, when we have such a scheme that we have one sender and many receivers. Okay, if for example, if you want to pass some information to all the processes. One process read some information from the input data, and now we need to pass this information to all processes. Then we can use collective communication, send this information to all processes. Okay, but this also works in the opposite direction. Okay, you may, for example, try to gather some information from one process, try to gather some information that was sent from many processes. Okay, so these are collective communication methods. Two groups, point to point and collective. Okay, so I think that it will be enough for today. Tomorrow we will move to more specific, more practical topics, let's say. I will show you how to send message, how to receive it, and then we'll try to how to initialize, how to deinitialize MPI environment within program, how to compile parallel program written using MPI, and how to run it. And then we'll try to write a very simple parallel program, but this is something that will be we'll discuss tomorrow. Okay, so for today is all. Thank you.